Hi, guys. I just wanted to relate my experience as an atheist coming from another country, much like the gentleman before you. I'm from Jamaica, and
we could tell very, that.
Thank you. Yeah, I do keep my accent even though I've been here.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Thank you. So I don't know if you know, you probably do, but Jamaica is a very, very Christian nation.
Yes. Yeah.
And being an atheist or gay, Jamaica
right.
is looked upon as you know, as an inadequacy.
Yeah.
So, growing up, I was a youth minister. I was in the church up until about until I was about 19 years old. By that time, I was, you know, full of angst and having sex with all the church girls. But that's the point. Yeah. I was.
I tossed that nugget out there.
It's a little drawback to the. The years of going through all those things in my head, you know. But growing up, there's a lot of support in the Black community for it, that if you are a Christian, right? And I felt that, you know, support coming all the way up until I was about that age, 19 years old. Everything was going well, but when I turned about 14 years old or so, I started, you know, having a lot of questions about things, just reading the Bible and, which I suppose how most people do become atheists is reading the Bible for what it is and how violent and how hateful it actually is. So, being in that country, it's really hard to try to relate it to someone. So we really, you know, hold it in a lot, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So it was weird being that age and having all those questions and just, you know, not knowing who to ask or anything. So going into high school, I met some of my best friends who are, you know, still my best friends now, and not all of them are atheists, but they, you know, at least listened. And that is an important part, you know, someone just being there to listen to you, to be able to take that load off you.
Mm-hmm.
And doing that, you know, I was actually, it's an eye opener. It was an eye opener to me because, We Jamaicans have been known to kill atheists. Jamaicans have been known to kill gay people.
Yeah.
So, you know, that fear kind of traps you. It's kind of different now, but yeah. So.
Hope it's getting better.
So, as I moved here, and I moved to Georgia. And, you know, growing up watching TV and all that kind of thing, you know, thinking that United States is, you know, a very open-minded country, you know. So coming
to Georgia.
Well. No, but, you know, from another country, you paint the whole
right,
nation as one thing. So coming here, you know, I was like, okay, you know, I'd actually be, you know, accepted, you know. But speaking to my people, as in Black people,
mm-hmm.
you know, they have been even more standoffish than anyone else when it comes to religion. Anybody.
Yeah.
You know, so it's weird coming here and it's like, okay, so no support still. Okay, fine. Okay.
So this is exactly why Mandisa Latifa Thomas founded Black Nonbelievers.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I was just about to go there. It's based out of Atlanta, Georgia. As a matter of fact, that's where the original place was. I'm not sure if you're around that area, but there is a chapter there, and they actually have a fairly large chapter that's active on that side, including Mandisa herself, which is moving mm-hmm. into this full time. But yeah, you are right. You will find there. I don't want to stop your story there before you finish. But yeah, there is a lot of resistance that you'll have from other people that are African Americans. And so trying to find that support as you, as an atheist, that it's more difficult to come by. I'll say it that way. It's getting better, in my opinion, but yeah, there's still a lot of pockets around that. Yeah, it's pretty difficult.
I mean, it's important to note that it's getting better because of the work of people like Mandisa,
right,
who are out there working to normalize atheism in a community that's been pretty hostile to atheists, the African-American community, and then also to basically elevate the concerns of black nonbelievers in the secular community that's been at best indifferent to their concerns for a long time. And so it's important work, and the fact that you're in Atlanta is an awesome opportunity because you could participate firsthand with black nonbelievers.
Oh, he is in Atlanta.
Yeah, he is.
Oh, no kidding. I couldn't see it because it was in the way, but that is a thing. If you're there,
so thank you for that information. I didn't know about.
Please look them up.
It's just watching the show today that I really found out about that. I'm new to your show, and I really appreciate that you guys put it out there to actually have a stage where we can relate to anybody. It doesn't have to be black people. It doesn't have to be, you know, we can just relate to somebody that has been in our shoes or anything, you know, like that. And I also want to commend, as I said, I'm from Jamaica, so there has been a huge Rastafarian influence. Mm-hmm. And there is a radio personality named Muta Baruka. And he was actually one of the people that I used to hide away and listen to on the radio. And he used to really push people to really open up their minds and think more freely than they actually are, you know, just reading the Bible and taking it as law, you know. And he got a lot of hate. He still does from Jamaicans, even from Rastafarians, because they kind of try to stay in the biblical sense. They try to match up our history with biblical history, which you can't do. So, he was one of the people that, you know, really put it out there that, look, you know, you don't have to take the Bible as law. You know, he's a Rastafarian, so technically he's a pantheist. But he was one of those people that really awakened a sense of really trying to explore and trying to find out what's really going on in the world. You know, so I have to comment, even though he's not an atheist, I have to commend him and for the work that he's still doing now, you know. And I just wanted to put that out there. I just wanted to put my story out there as well, you know. I've been a black non-believer from Jamaica. And we don't have organizations or calling shows or that kind of thing. So, you know, I just wanted to do my part.
Well, we appreciate that.
Yeah. Thanks for the call. Yeah,
thank you.
Thanks for the information.
No problem. And thank you for yours as well. I'll check out the Black Non-Believers of Atlanta.
All right.
Go ahead and check it out.
All right. Sounds good.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. And thank you for listening.
Sure. No problem.
All right. Yeah. Well, that was very worthwhile. Mendes, another member of
you know, from... join up there somewhere already. Right. I hate that I couldn't actually see.
Yeah.
The name of it. If that was the case, I would have went straight there. Well, let me tell you about this here chapter.
Yes. How fortunate you called today.
Yeah. There's a
all
lot
right.
of. Oh, sorry.
No. Go ahead.
I was about to say there's. Like the stories that I've heard, like even people being atheists and being gay in Jamaica and Trinidad, it's just, like there's some horrific stories that come out of that when, even if you're not necessarily gay, but someone suspects you of being gay or has, you know, a beef with you or whatever else, like, I mean, it can be, I've seen videos of like, you know, pseudo like mob crew type deals that go on, and it's just I can't even believe that this is.
And if you've ever been to Jamaica and you see how small that island is, it's like if somebody's after you, there's really not anywhere for you to go.
Right. So. Like if I went there like on vacation, like I would stay on like the tourist side of things. Like, I wouldn't venture out, even though I would want to. I would love to do that and explore the food and the culture and everything else that's there. But it's like, if you get into the wrong entanglement, I wouldn't even know what to do, where to go, who to call. Let's just run back to the hotel. Like, is that an option you have? But yeah, that's just something else. Anyway.
All right.